Number 13, I mean, this is a moment for her. It's a duty, but one that she presumably takes very seriously.
It is one that she takes very seriously. You're absolutely right. Number 13 on the 13th of July. So let's hope that bodes well for Theresa May. But since 1649 and the execution of Charles I, the sovereign has remained above party politics and acts purely on the advice of his or her ministers. So today the Queen was really fulfilling her constitutional duties, something that she takes very seriously indeed, and all that is involved in that, the ceremony and the tradition. So as you mentioned, David Cameron came first and tendered his resignation, which she graciously accepted. Shortly after he left Buckingham Palace, the new Prime Minister arrived, only the second female of the Queen's reign, and indeed in the country's history.
Yeah, and arrived very shortly afterwards, actually. I think her car had to slow down because David Cameron was still pulling out of the palace. There also is that weekly meeting with the Prime Minister. Now, talk a little bit about that, because you know, the Queen is famously apolitical, but what happens in those meetings?
Well, those meetings, much like today, are private. There's no record kept, and the only people present in the room during those meetings are indeed the Queen and the current Prime Minister. So it'll be years from now when historians are really given access to the Queen's private diaries that we have a sense of how she felt about her Prime Ministers. But David Cameron said just recently, in fact, that during his time with her, certainly, that she has asked brilliant, well-informed questions, that she likes to know what's going on. So certainly, given the political fallout over the last few weeks, I think the Queen is going to have a lot of questions for Theresa May looking ahead to the future. But during that time, all of the Prime Ministers at one time or another have said that the Queen, really, that she's seen everything. If you think Winston Churchill was her very first Prime Minister, she's been through it all, she's experienced it all, she's seen the country's ups and downs. So really, she's there as a voice of wisdom, that she can't sway a political decision, but she's there to offer advice, to ask the right questions, and to make you think about what you're doing.
Yeah, everything I've been reading today about the those meetings is she does ask pointed questions. I mean, you know, officially no opinion and not influencing that, but she's vitally interested with what's going on. You mentioned Winston Churchill. I also learned today that he was initially unimpressed with the young monarch, but she won him over.
He became very fond of her. I mean, when the Queen came to the throne, it was largely a man's world. Churchill had had a very good relationship with her father, the King, but there was this young 25-year-old woman stepping off the plane. What was she possibly going to know about politics? But the Queen is very savvy, she's very well read, she's remarkably up to date on everything that is going on, not just in the UK, but across the Commonwealth. And so she likes to remain informed, and people have said that even around Buckingham Palace, she knows everything that's going on. You can't get anything past her. And so really, she presents a wealth of information to these younger prime ministers that are coming up. I think David Cameron, she actually saw him in a play when he was 8 years old. He was in Toad of Toad Hall with her son, Prince Edward. So she's really seen him grow up.
That's a good way to make the prime minister feel old. I saw you on stage when you were 8. With that apolitical nature of it, and it is a very important thing. Why is it that way? I mean, why is it that the Queen, people watching who aren't in Great Britain, why is it that she has to stay out of it all?
Well, she's our neutral head of state, and she takes that neutrality very seriously. If she was seen to be getting involved in any respect, there would be an enormous amount of criticism. And it dates back, as I mentioned before, to 1649 when Charles I was executed. At that time, that's when it was decided that the sovereign should remain above party politics. Early in the Queen's reign, she had a lot of criticism about the issue of royal prerogative. And so in 65, the Conservative Party introduced an electoral procedure to make it fair in terms of electing future party leaders. And so really, it's the cleanest way to be, and she takes that very seriously. So it'll be many years from now, unfortunately, after our time, Michael, that anyone knows what she really thinks.
Yeah, exactly. She'll probably outlive me, that's for sure, the way she's going. Victoria Arbiter, Royal Commentator, thanks so much. Great to see you.
Likewise. Thanks very much.